Good morning. I 12 minutes. I want to. I would like to begin my presentation with a story from the beginning of the time. In fact, the story begins. Begins in Europe, in to be more precise, in Italy, in a northern city of Italy named Bologna. In 1088, in Bologna was created the first university in the world. In this time, people believed that the world was flat. And in this time, people believed too that the fastest mode of transport was a horse. And believed that the coolest clothes were armor. And even believed that the more advanced and sophisticated medical treatment used leeches. All these things have changed in 10 centuries, except for one thing: university. I came from a university that has a mission. That has as a mission to teach people throughout their whole lives. And for us, it's very important to have solved how can we do this. Roger Shank, after helping thousands and thousands people in companies to learn, concludes that people hate learning. If this is the case, and I agree with him, I'm a professor, we have a huge problem. How do produce lifelong learning in my university if people hate learning? One of the ways to solve this problem, this conflict that we have created, is to consider our students as audience. Audience, as TV audiences or radio audiences. But what really is an audience? An audience is a group of people that are attracted, captivated, and persuaded to return to a program. This is an audience. What are the features, the real features of an audience? I have detected 6 or 7 features, main features. The first of them is that the audience is a free public. This afternoon, when we will return at home, we will decide this afternoon, this evening, what is the best program to see in our TV. And the best professionals of entertainment have prepared the most interesting and amazing programs for us. But it's me, the person that decides if this program is good for me. The audiences in media are really the freest public that they know. In other way, the audiences has the power of decision because we decide what is the program that best suits our needs in each moment. Another thing interesting is that the results of the audience determine the future of our program. I remember in Spain several years ago, a program, a late night show, remains remained for almost a decade in prime time in Channel 5. Its name was Crónicas Marcianas. For Spanish people, it's quite famous, this program. Its competitor, Channel 3, decided to copy the format and they created a new program, a new late night show, with a host with a very similar profile. The program was cancelled 8 weeks after. Audience decided for programmers. Another thing interesting is that programs leave an indelible memory. For Spanish people of my generation, if we hear the sentence Chaqueta Muerto, we can remember the deepest sadness we felt the summer that the final episode of this TV series, Verano Azul, Blue Summer, was shown in television. And I'm sure that in your brains now, you are seeing scenes of several TV series or movies or sentences that really mark your lives. It's true, and that is true in the sense that always the programs affect our lifestyle. We change our outfits, we change our behaviors after seeing programs or movies in television or in cinema. In conclusion, a program aims to surprise, to retain, to entertain, and to keep the audience come back. Now I want to compare this reality, these features of the audiences, with the reality of our students. And we can see that we find an opposite reality from the university and the schools in comparison with the media programs. In one side, the audience is a free public, and the other one, the students are captive audience. What means captive audience? Captive audience is the public that the professor don't need to attract, captivate, and retain in its performance, in their performance. In one side, the power of decision is in the audience's hands, and the other side, the power of decision is in our hands, the hands of professors, the hands of programmers. The result determines the future of a media program and don't determine the future of the learning programs. In one case, the programs leave an indelible memory, and unfortunately, in the other case, our learning programs don't leave this kind of memory. I can't remember more than two or three names of my best professors. The program affects, in several cases, the life of the audiences, and on the other side, the programs don't affect the life of our students. As said to the first director of the newspaper Times, facts are sacred, but the comment is free. These are the facts. We are, from my university, we are trying to change and to permit new developments of our students. And we are sure of a thing, that if learning isn't an interesting and easy issue, our mission would be more and more and more and more difficult, because we need that people want to learn each day. I want to introduce one video, but when we have created the unit of to create contents to learning in my university, we were really proud. But after that, we discovered that we weren't pioneers in this field. The American Army in the Second World War produced educational films to teach soldiers on the front, because they need more and more soldiers to be prepared with new knowledge about new weapons and knowledge about new war tactics. And soldiers died on the battlefield. And they decided to produce educational films with the appeal of the Hollywood films and the knowledge of the military classes. Please introduce the video.
Las instrucciones son claras. Tu objetivo es matar japoneses y alemanes. Debes aprender a matar a tu enemigo antes de que él te mate a ti. No aprenderlo es un error que te costará la vida. El mariscal de campo y comandante del Estado Mayor alemán, von Keitel, admitirá más tarde: nuestro mayor error fue subestimar la celeridad y maestría de las películas educativas de los aliados.
Okay, thank you. The last sentence said that the General von Keitel, an officer of the Nazi army, said we underestimate the power and the value of the educational films produced by Allies army to win Second World War. Finishing, usually each of us watch for almost 4 hours of television each day. If there are some of us that are thinking it's not my case, we are putting in other someone else the extra hours, because you should remember that this data is an average. And also, we are consuming 2 hours of radio per day, and almost an hour of video games. But in my country, Spain, adult people only use 90 minutes per day to learn formal courses. When I explain my job, and I finish with that, when I explain my job, I use a metaphor. The metaphor of the tightrope walker. And the tightrope walker is on the rope, navigating between two pillars. One of these pillars is learning, and the other one is entertainment. If the right rope walker decides to put itself near the pillar of learning, our content will be an appeal for students. But if the walker decides to put itself near the pillar of entertainment, our content will be appealing, but not worth learning. The result or the conclusion is that the tightrope walker must be or must put himself in a perfect balance between learning and entertainment. And what's the way to produce this situation between the learning and entertainment? In our case, the way is to create a learning plot. What's a learning plot? A learning plot, it's a plot created from the knowledge of an expert in a book, for example, and to create a plot that introduces engaging stories and learning layers. And after that, we can produce with professionals of media, TV formats, radio broadcasts, magazines, or even novels to do to our students and to enhance and to improve learning. I have 2 examples to finish my presentation. 1 minute is 30 seconds for each one. One of these, the first one, is a documentary that immerses a journalist 44 hours in a water purification plant. Please.
Nos encontramos en una edad considerada de grandes dimensiones, con una capacidad de tratamiento de 480.000 metros cúbicos de agua al día. Actualmente se tratan 289.000 metros cúbicos de agua al día, correspondientes a una capacidad de tratamiento de 2 millones de habitantes equivalentes. Para que todo esto se lleve a cabo de forma satisfactoria es necesario coordinar muchos factores, factores humanos, factores tecnológicos y factores económicos. Hoy, en el equipo de reporteros, aprenderemos cómo se opera una depuradora en condiciones normales. Hola Javier,
hola.
Encantada de conocerte.
Hola,
jefe de planta de esta edad,
sí,
¿nos va a explicar cómo funciona todo?
Por supuesto, si te parece, ir a mi despacio y comentamos con calma.
Venga, pues vamos. La gestión de explotación y mantenimiento de una depuradora de aguas residuales requiere el conocimiento de muchos campos, de la misma manera que también se necesitan diferentes perfiles de personal para llevar a cabo esta empresa.
How to manage a water purification plant. The other example is a sitcom modeled on the Big Bang Theory, starring two people that live together, and we use that to teach risks in banking. Yes.
David, ¿cómo podéis salvar la antoja de un hámster y tú?
Una explicación lógica y razonable. Pantalones con bolsillos ultra imantados, la solución definitiva.
Una aplicación. David Lyon Trader con su cabello.
Mamá, soy yo. ¿Qué quiere? ¿40 euros?
Todas las startups, posicionamiento, gastos de gestión, LinkedIn.
Estoy oliendo.
This is our solution, treating the contents and mixing learning and entertainment. And I finished paraphrasing Armstrong, not the signals by the astronaut, that said it's a small step for the university.